Elena, are you ready? I'm launching the myth-busting machine.
Sure, go for it.
I should warn you, it may get loud.
Okay.
Hey guys, my name's Amy, and I'd like to know if it's really possible to clean up the ocean. Who are you gonna call when you feel it open up inside your head? Do you wanna know where the story goes or make it up instead? Now you're complicated, scares us to the bone, but no one says you're better off alone.
Hi everyone, today we're going to answer one important question. Can we really clean up the ocean? Is this really possible? Or how much of it can we clean?
Camille has been squeezing researcher Kim Martini, or her knowledge, I should say. We introduced her in the last episode.
I have been challenging her, like everyone who comes on the show, as you know.
Yeah, you're the man for that, all right.
We fight hard to bring you the truth, that's all, beloved listeners.
How's about we jump right in?
Let's do it. Who you gonna call, Mythbusters? Can we really clean up the ocean? We said it's more of a good-to-know question, really. For those who are just joining in, we believe the real answers to the ocean plastic problem are upstream. But yes, we should also consider the feasibility of cleaning up what we can. So, here we are.
You have a disclaimer message?
I do. The following views can sound a little bit critical. I want to say that we praise the existing efforts of everyone involved in some way in environmental actions. Everyone. It is important to mobilize engineers, innovators, entrepreneurs, and anyone who is interested in giving a hand to find solutions and clean up what we can of ocean plastic.
Those efforts are really important. Keep it going.
What we are challenging with this myth-busting episode is the fact that ocean cleanup has been occupying a large majority of the mainstream media space, mainly via the work of Boyan Slat and the Ocean Cleanup Project. And this is sometimes steering the debate in the wrong direction, even in most specialized circles. So together, we're going to find out what is possible today, and what we can expect for the years to come.
Spoiler alert!
You're probably going to get disappointed.
But that'll be productive for the investigation as a whole.
Actually, you know what? I'll go ahead and save you time right now, because you're busy. If you just want to know if we can clean up the ocean, the answer is much closer to the no than to the yes. You guessed it. And things are not likely to change anytime soon. Why? Because it's not only a technology issue.
What a spoiler you are, Camille.
Yeah, it's more productive, that's all.
Now, if you want to understand the nuances and dig into this with us, stick around.
And if by now you know enough, just move on. We won't get offended, I promise.
So, why did you pick Kim Martini? Who is she? Why should we trust her?
Okay, good question. Well, first, because she's an oceanographer.
How to introduce myself. Hi, my name is Dr. Kim Martini. I'm a physical oceanographer, so that means I study the physics of the ocean. But to do that, I've spent a lot of time deploying instruments in the ocean. And right now I work with how to get the best data from that instruments. But on my side time, I like to tell people about the ocean. So I do a lot of outreach through blogging or Twitter.
She blogs at Deep Sea News, which is a nice channel if you want to follow ocean topics in general.
I would say that we're not your normal ocean bloggers because we like to use popular culture and humor and cold, hard scientific facts to get to tell people about what's going on in the ocean.
Cold, hard scientific facts, humor and pop culture written by scientists. That sounds like a blog you'd want to read, right?
And people I'd like to hang out with too, actually.
And worth mentioning, she really wants to find cleanup solutions. And that's an important qualifier for this interview. She wants a clean ocean tomorrow, like you and me.
I want to in my heart. You know, I'm on the same page with them. I want to see a solution. I want to see something that works. I am horrified when I go to the beach. I am horrified when I go out and there's stuff everywhere.
Fair enough. She's not the naysayer we sometimes see in those debates, it seems.
No, she actually hates the idea of being part of that myth busting, but she felt it's her duty to tell the truth. It's well needed.
And she studied the Ocean Cleanup Project specifically, right?
Yes, in great detail, actually.
So please, don't tell me
We can't clean this up together. Thank you very much.
Because when the Ocean Cleanup Project went viral and Boy and Slat finally released a comprehensive feasibility study back in 2014, hundreds of pages of technical stuff no YouTube viewer would understand. She and her colleague were asked to do a scientific peer review of the study, which is a common practice in the scientific community. But no one else was up for it. So she took care of the engineering part, and her colleague, Dr. Miriam Goldstein, took care of the biology part.
Okay.
And you know, before we jump into the technicalities, I want to look at this from a change management perspective, because there's something that comes back all the time. We, human beings, have a big talent for oversimplification. When I look at a question, such as, can we clean up the ocean, I want to hear yes or no. I don't have the time nor the interest to understand the nuances. I just love the story of this young champion that seems to have a plan, and that's what I feel like standing behind. And this is a classic case with change stories. Now, the reality is more complicated than this, and we need people to do the homework and look into the details of potential solutions. That's number one. And number two, we need to start getting used to nuances, conditions, variables, and looking at the big picture.
People like Kim help us understand the nuances.
Exactly.
So, thank you, people like Kim. So, what did you cover first?
Well, we started talking about the disproportionate visibility of the Ocean Cleanup Project, because it's probably the most prominent solution to date. It now received millions of dollars of funding, and I wanted to ask Kim what we can hope from it, really.
Yes. Actually, our colleague Sorenza found out that if you go on YouTube and go through the first 20 videos for the search Ocean Pollution, 50% of the views go to the Ocean Cleanup Project.
Right. And I'm not surprised. Here's how Kim puts it.
It's so compelling because it's such a simple narrative. I will use the ocean to clean itself. All you have to do is, this is a problem that now he's framing it as, if we just throw a lot of money at the problem, then it will solve itself. You don't have to do anything to change. You are not personally responsible. And it's so easy. He just frames it as this very easy problem that's solvable with engineering. And I would disagree with that.
General rule of thumb for you busy people with no time to check the feasibility of a solution: when it's too good to be true, you probably want to keep reservations.
Or call the Mythbusters.
Right.
Can we get into the engineering challenges now?
Sure. So that's Kim's expertise. Do we have the technology, and will we have it in 10 years, 15 years, etc.? I always thought there must be something usable in the work of the Ocean Cleanup Project. Behind all the glitter, there might be stuff we can actually apply today or in the short term.
Can you note any substantial progress in the previous years? Like, what is the pace of innovation, and is this going to get somewhere?
I think they're doing a good effort of trying to address the engineering challenges. I think they're trying to address, finally, the biofouling challenges. They're doing that. So it seems like they're moving in the right direction. Those were the two major challenges that we outlined in our review, which was, we wrote 4 years ago. But I would also say that in our review, too, one of the main points is that we said that making deep ocean moorings is really hard.
I pause here for a sec. If, like me, you were wondering what is a deep ocean mooring, it's like a collection of devices that are connected to a wire and anchored on the seafloor. Deep, really deep in the ocean.
Just to even engineer the structure. They were going to make the world's largest ocean structure. That's what they were saying, to pick up trash. And we said, well, that's really hard. That's a hard technical challenge. That is, we've never done that from an engineering standpoint as humans. We've never made something that large. And, you know, and it was really interesting because we said that. We said, look, moorings are hard. And we said that 4 years ago. And gosh, was it this past spring, the Ocean Cleanup had a big press release, and they said, oh yeah, moorings are really hard. We're going to do this other floating idea. And thought, well, you know, we kind of said that 4 years ago. And to say, you know, and it's like, well, okay, they're moving forward, but how far forward have they moved on if we said that 4 years ago? And I would also like to point out that having freely floating structures that are freely drifting is another huge technological challenge that has its own incredibly complicated problems.
It looks easy on the slideshow.
Oh, it does look very easy on the slideshow, but it's not. And I think they really oversimplified the engineering that's going to be involved in that. I think they simplify everything. And I mean, that's what you have to do. If you want to tell somebody about your problem, what you're trying to do, and it's highly technical, you do have to simplify it. You have to make it easy to understand, but you also have to be realistic about the challenges. And I don't think they're saying this because it sounds like they have a lot of really good technical people, but the ocean is a really mean place, and it is really hard on your instruments. It is really hard on anything you put in there. And I think sometimes they really underestimate the wrath of the sea.
So, Aileen, here's the first punchline. There are real engineering challenges that tend to be greatly underestimated, and it sounds like we are really far from a solution someone like Kim can really believe in.
How about solutions other than the ocean cleanup project one?
A good question. I ask her, what's the potential of any solution out there?
Oh boy. So it's a really hard problem.
I like how she calls you boy when she says, oh boy.
Oh yeah? Here it is one more time.
Oh boy. So it's a really hard problem. Okay, so we'll start with that one. There's a lot of plastic. It's all over the place. It's at different levels, but it's also really scattered. So how are you going to do something that's efficient enough to pick up a lot of plastic, but then also pick up usable plastic and not pick up everything else too? So that's something that people have to think about. You know, you're scooping up stuff that's been in the ocean, but you're not only picking up plastic. It's kind of like there's a lot, you know, you can just use a fishing term. There's bycatch.
That is the problem all technical solutions are confronted with. Bycatch.
Yes, because it seems plastic is really everywhere. In the Arctic, in the deep oceans, at the surface, everywhere really.
Yeah, so punchline number two, you can't really pick up plastic without picking up all of the other stuff as well. It's a real fish and plastic soup out there.
But wait, I can go with the idea that we can't pick up everything, but at least all the big pieces that lie in the patches, you know, that stuff Charles Moore is standing on in his famous videos?
That is exactly what I asked, because I was thinking the same. That stuff should be easy to remove.
I'm not sure that we can. In my limited view, so I am going to say that I wouldn't say that I have a hand on every single technology that's going out there, but I really don't see a really good feasible way of going out and picking all that stuff up that's going to work. There's just so much trash in the ocean.
And something we forget is that the Great Pacific Garbage Patch, for instance, is about the size of Texas.
Actually, I'm looking at estimates here, and you're talking about the low range estimate. Some estimate 15 million square kilometers. That's around 8% of the ocean surface.
Yeah. You get the idea. But still, I didn't want to take no for an answer. I asked her about the different systems out there. There might be something promising. And we reviewed together the main ideas that have been put forward.
For me, the ones that I think that are the most successful so far are like the Baltimore Trash Wheel.
So the Baltimore Trash Wheel is a system that is placed at a river catchment, powered by the river currents or solar power. It has a big wheel, like, you know, on the old boats or mills, and it actions a rail that brings up the trash that is floating around, and it drops it into a container. They picked over 500,000 tons of trash over the last 3 years. 500,000 tons. Including 9 million cigarette butts and 500,000 polystyrene containers.
Nice.
And it does a really good job.
But?
Oh no, there's a but.
But again, this is a really great solution, but it's only limited to places where you have riverine inputs and that you places that you can actually put it in. So, you know, you're not going to be able to do this in the middle of a shipping channel. So how are you going to block off the flow? Are you going to do it in the small area? So that one's limited as well. So
it's limited, but it's great. That is exactly where efforts should be deployed, developing a multiplicity of local solutions that work for a specific context.
I see. And that's often on preventing more plastic from getting into the ocean in the first place.
Which links to our next punchline. There's no silver bullet. Like with everything, there are so many different situations that the engineering challenges are humongous. You can develop a solution that is tailored to a specific situation, like they did in Baltimore, but the claim that we can clean up the ocean is just too big.
Yeah, that makes sense.
And in case you are still not convinced, there's another argument that she brought up. Collateral damage. And bycatch is one of them, as we discussed. But also
other things, because you're using a net, you're going to start catching other fish or harming things. There's always that possibility. So there's, you know, that there's, I do think that's actually a good way to do it. But if you're going to do that on a large scale, that's also has its challenges too. And also you're just going to use a lot of gas chugging around in two boats. And so then you have this other collateral damage, right? So you really have to think of, you know, what's the cost to benefit ratio for all of this?
Yeah, I hadn't thought about that. All the pollution from such large-scale operations? I guess we have no idea of the size of the problem.
And the financial cost. The capital expenditures from all this. That's an important point as well. First, is there any money for this? Who is going to pay the bill? The plastic producers? They don't even want to hear there's a problem at all. The business model is very unclear because a very large majority of this plastic, even if we could collect it, has no value whatsoever, which is why it ended up here in the first place. And now it's degraded and there's a mussel on it. Nothing you can do with that. So that's another nail in the coffin for the cleanup narrative. If there are millions and millions of dollars available right now to solve the ocean plastic problem, it should go into preventing the leak.
Yeah, making sure nothing else gets into the ocean ever, starting now.
Because right now we're talking about millions of tons every year.
At least 8 million tons a year, actually, that we'll probably never be able to catch back.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. And here's the big idea. The more upstream we put our efforts, the more impact, and the cheaper it is going to be to solve the problem in the end.
Upstream. And that's what we're going to cover in the rest of this series.
But you know, I don't like to give up. I hate to feel we can't do anything.
Yeah, I feel you.
I thought I would ask Kim a different question then. Instead of can we clean up the ocean, I ask her how much she believes in a workable solution for reversing the trend, technically reversing the trend. And I ask her to score from 1 to 10, 10 being the strongest chances to reverse the trend. You know what she told me?
Oh boy.
Exactly.
Oh boy. I'm going to put on my cranky pants for this one. I don't see a lot of this. I see that we can make a lot of change on how much is going in. So I would say a 4, but I would say what's going in there is there, what is gone in and what is going in is so high. And even the future estimates of how this might be doubling in the next 10 years are so high that I don't, unless we're cutting it off from getting into the ocean, I don't exactly see how it's, we're going to get rid of this problem, being as we can't even get a lot of it out yet.
Okay. Can we end on a positive note, please?
Yeah, let's try. Yeah, you're making me think of another point she made, just looking about the efforts to date.
To be fair, these are all projects that have taken a lot of prototyping. They've taken a lot of work. They've taken a lot of iteration. And that's where we are at now. We're at this sort of small scale stuff. We do need bigger scale stuff, but we have to work up from these small victories too. So I think the ocean cleanup should really think about these kind of models and the prototyping that they've done. Because the reality is that the ocean cleanup, they're 5 years in. They have not removed one piece of trash from the ocean yet. There are a lot of money. They are $20 million in. The Baltimore Water Wheel, it's removed tons and tons of garbage, and they're only $800,000 in. So a fraction of the cost. And so that's a solution that's working and removing plastic from the ocean. The ocean cleanup, they're not yet.
Working from the small victories.
Local, specific solutions.
To prevent plastic from leaking into the ocean in the first place. I see.
You got it. Conclusion.
Can we clean up the ocean? Not really. What's already there is there. And it's going to be a sad reminder of how pathetic we are.
Boyenslet cannot save us. Although he's a remarkable entrepreneur with a lot of talent, which we hope he will start deploying towards preventing the 8 million tons a year that reach the ocean in the first place.
Basically, if you want to go to a beach cleanup on a weekend or develop a local solution for your city, a student project, that kind of thing, you should. You really should. It's important. But technological solutions should really focus on preventing plastic pollution, not cleaning it.
For the rest, all of the money, media attention, and human efforts are better off focusing on upstream solutions. The people who can really save us work in industry, product and service design, for instance, and last but not least, policymakers can save us. They need to create the environment for the world to take another direction, but that's for another day.
Okay, myth number one, busted.
We'll be back soon with more green knowledge, inspiration, and entertainment.
And less plastic pollution.
Yes, indeed. Keep up the good work in the meantime. Who are you gonna call when you feel open up inside your head? Do you wanna know where the story goes or make it up and say? Now you're complicated, scares us to the bone. No one said you're better off alone.